Welcome to Spoken Injustice, where we put the criminal justice system in the dock. Is our fascination with true crime leading us to fabricate and envision monstrous serial killers, wrongly attributing systemic failures or even natural occurrences to the actions of individuals, when in reality some events may appear suspicious only due to our predisposition to view them through a suspicious lens? And what about half-truths? Half-truths are more dangerous than outright lies. While a lie is an outright falsehood, a half-truth is a statement that is partially true but leaves out important information or context. This can create a false impression or lead to incorrect conclusions. Additionally, because a half-truth contains some truth, it is often more difficult to recognize and call it out as false. It is not by chance that when referring to truth in criminal trials, we rightly refer to the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. But are we omitting too often the whole element when referring to truth in criminal trials? Particularly in criminal cases, it is commonplace that when the prosecution wants to convince a judge or a jury that an event was caused in a specific way, rather than providing the specific way in which the event was caused, relies on statistical evidence, citing the infinitesimal probability of that result emanating from an alternative natural cause. In other words, the prosecution says, because the fact that this event or set of events happening naturally are extremely low, then the event must be caused by the action of the accused. That evidence then becomes compelling, and all facts of the case are interpreted under those lenses. This is what happened, for example, in the case of Sally Clark, which we have already analysed, and if you have missed it, you can find it in the link below. This compulsion is not exclusive to accusatorial systems. Inquisitorial systems do make use of statistical evidence in a similar way, as it happened in the Netherlands in the case of Lucia de Berk. I will provide a brief background of the de Berk case in a moment, but before doing so, just very quickly, here are my usual reminders. To leave a like and subscribe to our channel if you enjoy our videos. Also, hit the notification bell to be notified when our next video is out. We post weekly. Thank you. The Lucia de Berk case, also known simply as the Lucia case, is a high-profile legal case that took place in the Netherlands involving allegations of serial murder and medical malpractice. Lucia de Berk is a Dutch nurse who worked in various hospitals in the Netherlands. In 2001, she was accused of murdering several patients under her care. The allegations were based on statistical analysis of unexpected death in the hospitals where she worked, as well as circumstantial evidence. Lucia de Berk was convicted in 2003 of murdering 7 patients and attempting to murder 3 others. She was sentenced to life in prison. The case relied heavily on statistical arguments and the assumption that the deaths were not due to natural causes, but were the result of foul play. The case generated significant controversy and debate within the medical as well as the legal community. Some experts questioned the validity of the statistical analysis used to link the deaths to Lucia de Berk and raised concerns about the reliability of the evidence presented during the trial. Over the years, doubts about Lucia de Berk's guilt continued to grow, and her case became a cause célèbre in the Netherlands. In 2008, the Dutch Supreme Court ordered a review of her case. In 2010, following the re-examination of the evidence, thanks to the work of an eminent statistician, Professor Richard Gill, and whistleblowers at the hospitals where the alleged murders took place, Lucia de Berk's convictions were overturned, and she was acquitted of all charges. The court found that the statistical analysis used in her initial conviction was flawed. A similar case in the UK, that of Ben Geen, also gained attention over the years and warns against unfounded and exaggerated statistics. Benjamin Geen, a nurse working at the Horton General Hospital in Banbury, Oxfordshire, was accused of murdering patients under his care and attempting to murder others. The case centered around allegations that he administered lethal doses of drugs, such as insulin and muscle relaxants, to patients who were not in need of such medication, causing their deaths or putting their lives at risk. The prosecution argued that Geen was responsible for a series of suspicious incidents in which patients had unexpectedly deteriorated or died while under his care. In 2006, Ben Geen was convicted of 2 counts of murder, as well as multiple counts of grievous bodily harm with intent and administering poison with intent to endanger life. He was sentenced to life in prison with a minimum term of 30 years. However, the case has been the subject of ongoing controversy and legal challenges. Some critics have raised concerns about the evidence presented during the trial, the methods used to link Geen to the alleged crimes, and the reliability of expert testimony. In the years following his conviction, Geen and his legal team launched multiple appeals maintaining his innocence. According to The Guardian, in an article released on the 31st of July 2023, now an analysis of a large dataset of patients in the US of similar profile to those involved in the Geen case has suggested that there was nothing unusual about the number of incidents of respiratory arrest on his ward in the winter of 2003 to 2004. Mark MacDonald, a barrister who is representing Geen on his convictions, said he would present the new statistical evidence to the CCRC in the expectation that they would refer the case to the Court of Appeal. He said the prosecution says there is a pattern, that he is on duty every time someone gets sick, and that respiratory arrest is rare. They've said you've never proven it is not rare. Now we have a report saying that it is not rare. Cases such as this highlight the potential dangers of relying too heavily on statistical analysis and circumstantial evidence in criminal trials. Statistical evidence is a common method for drawing conclusions about the likelihood or frequency of events or phenomena based on data. It involves collecting data, analyzing it, and using statistical techniques to make inferences.
Particularly in relation to trials where healthcare professionals are accused of murdering, in September 2022, the Royal Statistical Society, RSS, published a report tackling statistical bias in criminal trials related to these cases. The report was produced by a group within the RSS, which evolved from a working group of the same name set up in the early 2000s after the RSS wrote to the Lord Chancellor and made a statement setting out concerns around the use of statistical evidence in the case of Sally Clark. The article announcing the report reads, "Following several high-profile cases where statistical evidence has been misused, the Society calls for all parties in such cases to consult with professional statisticians and use only expert witnesses who are appropriately qualified." RSS CEO Stian Westlake, commenting on the report, said, "We have seen cases across the world of people wrongfully charged based on incorrect statistical analysis. We are calling for better collaboration between the legal and statistical communities to prevent such miscarriages of justice happening in future." The report summary states that cases in which healthcare professionals are suspected of killing their patients illegally are difficult to evaluate because they involve at least two levels of uncertainty. Investigators in such cases need to consider, one, whether the deaths that prompt the investigation could plausibly have occurred for reason other than homicide, and two, to consider whether, if homicide was indeed the cause, the person under suspicion is responsible. The recommendations made in such report were, amongst others, that all parties involved in investigation and prosecution in such cases consult with professional statisticians and use only such appropriately qualified individuals as expert witnesses. Also, experts informing an investigation should be kept blind to all aspects of the case, irrelevant to the questions they are being asked to answer. Blinding is a key tool in minimizing prejudicial subjective effects, such as unconscious bias.
For some critics with whom we share concerns, the use of expert evidence in some cases is objectionable, particularly in relation to statistical evidence when referring to the infinitesimal frequency of a natural cause beyond an event. So, referring to the cases we have analysed here, for example, the case of Sally Clark, the prosecution called upon Professor Sir Roy Medder, a leading British paediatrician of the time, who testified that the probability of two cases of sudden infant death syndrome, of SID for short, occurring in a family similar to Clark's was 1 in 73 million. The prosecution attempted to use this low probability to support the claim that the cause of death in both cases could have not been but their mother's conduct. Similarly, in the Berk case, an expert witness for the prosecution testified that the probability of so many natural deaths coinciding with a particular nurse's shift pattern was 1 in 342 million. In an article entitled Rethinking the Use of Statistical Evidence to Prove Causation in Criminal Cases, A Tale of Improbability and Free Will, Dr. Amit Pondek, a lecturer at Tel Aviv University Faculty of Law, who has also taught at Oxford University, says it seems that adducing statistical evidence that establishes the infinitesimal probability of alternative explanations is an effective way for the prosecution to convince the fact finder that results in question, in our case, for example, the infant's or patient's deaths, were caused by the accused. In the UK, the law on expert evidence is covered by common law as well as various statutes. The Law Commission launched a review into the law on expert evidence in 2011. Though this was for expert evidence in general, not just statistics. The Law Commission's decision to review was prompted by a call for reform from the House of Commons Science and Technology Committee, following concerns that expert opinion evidence was being admitted in criminal proceedings too readily, with insufficient scrutiny. The reform focused on the reliability of expert evidence and made the following key recommendations. A, to introduce a statutory admissibility test to be applied in appropriate cases whereby expert opinion is admissible in criminal proceedings only if it is sufficiently reliable to be admitted, the so-called reliability test. B, to provide by statutes judges with a single list of generic factors to help them apply the reliability test. And finally, C, to codify with slight modifications the uncontroversial aspect of the present law so that all the admissibility requirements for expert evidence will be set out in a single Act of Parliament and carry equal authority. The government, though, recognised the potential value of the proposed reliability test in reducing the risk of unsafe convictions arising from unreliable expert evidence, found that there was no robust estimate of the size of the problem to be tackled, either in terms of the number of cases where unreliable expert evidence is adduced, nor in the impact this has in terms of subsequently quashed convictions. The impact assessment published with the Law Commission's recommendations indicates that application of the new test would involve additional pretrial hearings with the concomitant, surprise, surprise, additional costs, but without sufficient reliably predictable savings to compensate for those costs. The government said rather than creating a statutory reliability test at this time, the government will invite the Criminal Procedure Rule Committee to consider amending the criminal procedure rules to ensure the judges are provided at the initial stage with more information about the expert evidence it is proposed to adduce. It endorsed by the committee, we believe that such changes, the government say, could increase the likelihood of trial judge and opposing party, where appropriate, challenging expert evidence. The government continues to say, although this will, of course, fall short of the recommended reliability test, the government considers that the amended criminal procedure rules will go some way towards reducing the risk of unsafe convictions as a result of unchallenged, inappropriate or unreliable expert evidence. However, as stated earlier, is inaccuracy or unreliability the only risk associated to statistics? Sometimes even a reliable statistic represents half-truth. And this is when things can go wrong, and this is what Professor Pondik refers to. He says, leaving aside the case in which the statistics are plainly wrong, as in the case of Clark, for example, even when statistical evidence is gathered, analysed and presented in a professional and reliable manner, the question remains, should a litigant be allowed to support their contention that the result was caused in a specific manner with evidence that the probability of an alternative cause is minute? This question is equally applicable to both juries and professional judges. The frequency of a possible cause, be it high or low, is meaningless in or of itself. It is necessary to compare the frequency of the potential cause with the frequency of the contrastive cause. Thus, for example, in the case of Sally Clark, the significance of the low frequency of two SIDS cases in similar families depends on the frequency of two murders of babies carried out by their mothers. Here too, this frequency is very hard to calculate. The expert witness for the defence, Professor Derwitt, proposed that an initial calculation will be 1 in 2 billion. However, it did stress that the calculation was for illustration purposes only, and that it was subject to the same objections that apply to Meadows' calculation. The important point is that if the frequency of double murder is lower than the frequency of two occurrences of SIDS in the same family, the statistics by which the probability of natural deaths is 1 in 73 million would serve as evidence against the prosecution's claim that the cause of death was Clark's conduct rather than SIDS. Professor Pundik concluded his article by stating that using statistical evidence regarding the infinitesimal frequency of a natural cause is objectionable, regardless of how reliable the statistical analysis is. And what are your thoughts? Should statistical evidence in relation to low frequency of a natural cause be banned or subject to strict admissibility rules when adduced in criminal trials? And should these concerns be taken more seriously at parliamentary level? Let me know in the comments below. Also, my appeal goes to those experts who have views on this subject and would like to enlighten our community with their thoughts and concerns. Our community would like to hear from you. I hope this video has provided you with some useful background into the dangers of statistics and half-truths in criminal trials. If so, leave a like and consider subscribing to allow us to continue bringing to you some of the most problematic issues involved in the often ignored issue of wrongful convictions. Also, join our networking hub at spokeninjustice.net to have your say as to the future content of this channel. We look forward to usher you as we sit and rise in this unique trial.